At the beginning of time, there was a tank, and all was good. They lobbed high explosive shells into trenches, firing machine guns. Life was simple. Until it saw another tank. And with this, the balance of the entire world was in jeopardy. How could this tank kill the other? Could the other one kill them? In reality, neither could. They were all using high explosive shells. But today, I, Lynx, will teach you, in this episode, of tank rounds and you, and why you don't want them fired at you. In the First World War, tanks didn't have dedicated armor-piercing rounds. They usually only had high explosive rounds. I believe there may have been solid core armor-piercing, but there weren't really enough tanks for British tanks to be firing at that needed that. German tanks, there was usually only one that actually worked at a time out of the four of them, and it was not a priority. I do wish that there were early landship battles, because that would have been fantastic. Mark IVs going against a German tank that never actually existed would have actually been pretty cool. First tank battles, that would be some cool history to cover. But unfortunately, they did not. But then World War II rolled around and people started to get their wish. Armor-piercing shells were induced in the simplest of terms, and they were around, filled with solid steel instead of TNT, and were pretty effective, although they were incredibly primitive. Only effective briefly, and became outdated quickly. I mean, it's not hard to improve. It's just basically a big metal slug. They had a chunk of metal, and you chuck that at the other chunk of metal that's the enemy tank, and you hope that something good happens. It's about as simple as it gets. Next up, from AP rounds, are APC rounds. APC rounds are armor-piercing capped rounds. They had a cap of softer metal to help the slug angle into slope armor just a little bit better. Kind of like it will hit. You'll see this diagram on screen right now. And so it will hit the metal, and the softer part will deform, angling the thicker metal into the plate and going in at less of an angle. Kind of cool. It made sloped armor not really that important. But people realized, unfortunately, these shells often, while not pinging off and landing two countries over like solid armor-piercing would, they did lose velocity pretty quickly due to the fact the front of the cap was just straight flat. It was a flat plate, basically, that made it to where it wouldn't ping off. But it typically, a cylinder without a cone on the front isn't super aerodynamic. Now, I hope you learned your ABCs in school, because it's about to get a little wild. After APC, they decided to make that actually hitting something with a solid smack was much more important than hitting something with kind of just a little flick. And they decided that making the front of their projectiles with a ballistic cap would make it more aerodynamic, more accurate, higher velocity, but it did not have the strength set that the armor-piercing cap had. And ultimately, they decided that hitting planes when a round was often deflected was at very least suboptimal. Their solution was rather simple, opposed to the name, which is completely not simple. The name is APCBC, or armor-piercing capped ballistic cap. They like cap so much that they put a cap on their cap so they could cap while capping tanks. Okay, I'll stop. Anyway, they start deciding that they want more deadly effects inside of tanks, and they start filling up AP rounds with explosives to detonate inside the tank, because a cloud of molten armor fragments bouncing around the turret and tearing through the hull and the people in the hull apparently wasn't enough to kill fleshy humans, according to the military planners. These shells had pretty poor armor-piercing capabilities and weren't that widely used after they figured out that you generally don't need it to explode in the tank if there's enough shrapnel flying around to turn everybody in there and Swiss cheese four times over. They called them HPHE, or armor-piercing high explosive. Some people called them semi-armor-piercing high-explosive, or SAPHE, but I'm just going to call them APHE for simplification, because this gets real complicated real fast. Modern rounds follow a different approach nowadays. Most tanks outside of the British Challenger tanks have smoothbore guns, and they fire APFSDS, or armor-piercing fin-stabilized discarding sabo. Thank Lord! Above, the army loves acronyms, or armies would have to spout absolutely insane names like that. They could just yell, load Sabot, or they could shout, load armor-piercing, fin-stabilized, discarding Sabot now! Why would they do that? They don't do that, because that takes way too much time. That's a super long word. Anyway, these are big, long darts that are supposed to punch a hole in armor. With this dart that is smaller than the barrel caliber, so sub-caliber round, so it can have less surface area while being super long. High velocity, good penetration, and not too much surface area to get meddled with. It can penetrate thick composite or reactive armors, and interestingly enough, these came after shaped charge warheads that became obsolete with most composite armor and explosive reactive armor warheads. Spoiler alert, the Russians aren't actually bulletproof to shaped charge rounds. The javelin is a shaped charge round, and they're definitely not immune to javelins. Russian ERA plates, however, still have to compete with tandem charge warheads that negate this defense. ERA panels will explode and send the hot jets somewhere else. And unfortunately, a tandem charge, the first charge sets the reactive armor off, and the second charge will blow straight through the armor after the explosion has gone off. Pretty nasty, and it makes your reactive armor not actually work at all. Before we move on to the next one, which is hesh rounds, my personal favorite, I want to just add a little fun fact. Depleted uranium used in U.S. Sabo rounds catches fire when exposed to air, meaning Spall in the tank will be on fire, also at the same time being molten while bouncing around the hole. Not super fun. You basically have scorching hot, almost molten metal flying around the inside of your tank. People on the inside of the tank have been reported to not like that. Now, I did mention British Challenger tanks as an exception to smoothbore guns, and they use hesh rounds that need the spin. Sabot rounds hate spin. Sabots have the fin, and without the fin, sabot rounds would tumble, and sabot rounds don't work if you hit them with the flat side, just kind of like a sword. If you stab somebody with a rapier, that's very different than taking the flat end and smacking somebody with it. So you'd lose energy to the rotation because of the rifled barrel, and then the sabot round would not be nearly as effective. That's why most armies go with smoothbore guns. The British, being as special as the British usually are, you know, with their special equipment, the British like to use hesh rounds. Hesh rounds need spin. I'll get into this in a second. So hesh rounds are British almost British exclusives in most rights, and stand for high explosive squash head. Now, you look at this fancy diagram right here. The plastic explosive squashes out before detonating due to the spin and sending an armor chunk bouncing around the cabin of the tank. Now, you might be wondering, where'd this come from? Why do you mean just an armor chunk's gonna fly off? Armor's not that brittle. Basically, it sends this big smack shockwave through the tank, and right where that thing exploded, it doesn't penetrate, but enough of the armor on the other side blows off, and that starts bouncing around the cabin. Now, if you're infantry, it might look a little strange. You'll just see a scorch mark on the side of the tank, and all of a sudden the tank will stop and be on fire and explode. It would look really strange. If I can find any footage of hesh rounds hitting stuff and their effects, I'm going to show them on screen right now, right here. You can see them if I found them. If I didn't find them, you can't see them. But if I did, ta-da, they're right here. Ho-ho, look at that. Look at this right here. Beautiful, beautiful hesh rounds. Hesh rounds are great because they're really silly. But last but not least are heat rounds. What's fun about heat rounds? Heat rounds use a shaped charge. Like this one right here on this diagram right here. We're using diagrams today. We're being scientific. And they send a hot jet of hot metal that's almost molten through the armor and into the crew and equipment on the other side. These don't need velocity. And a four-year-old with a heat round could send a KV-2 to Valhalla just by smacking one hard enough to set it off. They're not very useful in tank rounds anymore because they can be countered by ERA in composite armor in Western tanks, ERA in Russian tanks. Spoiler alert again, ERA works only sometimes. They're very useful, however, in something that isn't a gun. I mentioned how the four-year-old could probably send a KV-2 to Valhalla. That's because they don't need any velocity. They're kind of like self-contained ballistic events going on. You get your V of the metal, and then it goes into that jet of metal, right? That can happen with zero velocity. It can just sit there and go off and have the highest armor-piercing value it can have. That's pretty cool. And you may be thinking, hey, we can put that in a tank. That's what people thought. Until they decided, what if we put this on the end of a man-portable rocket launcher? Now you've got man-portable tank destroying. If you look at the Japanese, they put it on the end of a spear and did probably the craziest thing I've ever seen in warfare and literally charge a tank with an explosive spear. It actually worked sometimes. If those tanks didn't have infantry support, why didn't they have infantry support? And if they did have infantry support, what were you doing to allow a dude to sprint up to your tank with a spear? Anyway, rant over for that thing. Usually, because they can be so portable. They can be, they'll be used in anti-tank mines. They'll be used in rocket launchers. Like the Russian RPG-7 is a really good example of that. American Javelin missiles are also a great example of that. Anti-tank missiles from planes. Really anything anti-tank that isn't a gun uses these type of rounds. And they're probably the most common ones. And a good example to see why a tandem charge works very good against ERA is, you know, the Javelin. The American Javelin missiles supplied to Ukraine, those are tandem high-explosive anti-tank rounds. Now, ERA is supposed to counter heat rounds like that, but the only problem is tandem rounds will blow up the first explosive, and there's no second explosive, and the second one works. Also, with the top attack, it manages to fire through the roof, which sometimes doesn't even have an ERA on it, and the armor's thin enough that it'll punch through a lot of the time. Pretty stinking deadly. And I can kind of see why Western tanks went with the whole ERA idea. Or not ERA, not ERA, I'm an idiot. Composite armor idea. Out of all of these rounds, there's one thing that holds them all in common. If you get hit by one, you will wish you weren't. Unless you're suicidal, then you really want to be hit by one. But all of these things will kill you if you get hit by it, and it won't be fun. Although if I was going to be hit by any of these, hit me with a hesh round, because that would at least be kind of a cool way to go. I don't think I'd exist anymore. And that, my dear viewer, is the ammunition types of the modern age. And pre-modern age. But modern age, we're going to stick with that. And I hope you enjoyed the video, or at least learned something from this experience. Editor, take it away. Hi, if you're hearing this, we're not cutting into the fun part. What's the fun part? The fun part's the part where I edit. Actually, no, the fun part is the part I don't edit, which is the last part. The last part's the funnest part to edit, because I don't actually really have to edit anything. I just have to put me over me talking right now. Yeah, I'm going to be lowering the amount of videos I put out per week. One per week at max. Minimum's going to be at least two per month. I should have a video up this Friday. It's going to be a Ukraine video. It's going to be on Russian equipment and why some of it just doesn't seem to exist. You know, current warfare, it's fun to look at. But I got hit with the post-COVID brain fog really hard. And I keep forgetting what I'm talking about. So making videos is really difficult. I really like doing it, but it's becoming increasingly super difficult. And I'm going to try to keep it up. Whenever I see anything do good, I get really excited and want to make a new video immediately. So, you know, if you want to feed into my really unhealthy obsession, press the subscribe button once I get up to 50. I think I might have a heart attack and die if I wake up to 50 subscribers. But I'll try and never let it get to my head if I ever do get big. At least I doubt I will. But yeah, if you're watching this and you are subscribed, hi! I was gonna get a subscriber special video, but I didn't because I forgot about it. And if you are not subscribed, I recommend being subscribed. You know why? Because then you get to listen to me. I understand that I have really bad mumbling problems. I'm trying to get over that too at the moment. I'll be doing, after the new Ukraine video drops, I'll be doing a lot of trying to train my voice to stop mumbling. Because I know it's really hard to understand me and it's not that fun to listen to. I'm also trying to make my videos a bit louder because I noticed that my videos compared to other videos on YouTube are very quiet. And I imagine that's not very fun to listen to. But yeah, that's my end of video channel update. I'll see all of you on Friday or the day after Friday, depending on how much time I have. But it's going to be done this weekend, that's for sure. But goodbye, good folks and fellows, and I shall see you later.